It is now time for us to talk. The people are no longer able to distinguish light from dark. Your people are falling prey to the powers of darkness.
Here in Washington, the best stuff is hidden right there in plain sight.
Hey guys, how's it going? So I am very excited about this video. My main purpose here is to share some information about the Native American Indians and also to make some connections between the layout of the ancient ruins here in America and what many people refer to as the Mud Flood or Tartaria or the Great Reset and our lost history. If you're not familiar with the concept of the Mud Flood or Tartaria or the Reset, I would simply suggest that you watch a quick video from someone like Max Egan or Martin Litke from Flat Earth British or John Levi or Levi. These are all great channels and I'll be sure to put the links in the description. Now, just to be clear before I begin, these ancient ruins here in America were not the work of the Native American Indians who were living at some of these sites when the Europeans supposedly arrived here. Now, the fact does remain that the Native Americans were systematically destroyed and removed physically from the land and historically from our culture and minds. And it is funny, though, how what's left of our American ruins were turned into national parks where we are shown pictures of primitive Indians building fires and making clay pots, with maybe a passing reference to these sites being the work of even more ancient or distant cultures. Now, obviously the scope of these ruins makes it clear that no ordinary primitives built these amazing sites. This is also confirmed by several people from the 1700s. Most notably, I will reference the works of William Bartram and his experience living and traveling with different tribes of Native American Indians. Now, William Bartram is a historical figure, so as with any other person from our fabricated past, we must always be cautious and take any information with a grain of salt and analyze everything with logic and reason. I think that as a whole, his work provides a great window into the situation of the Native Americans, at least in the 1700s, but there are a few curiosities regarding the fate of his original manuscript of one very important document. And by the way, his writings were very pro-Native American and went against the mainstream propaganda that painted the Native Americans as savages. So before I make the connections between the ancient ruins and the mud flood buildings and what seems to be hidden in plain sight, as we will see, I first need to introduce and describe the ancient ruins that existed here in America in the 1700s. Again, none of the Indian tribes knew who actually built these ruins, nor what purpose they served. They were just as perplexed as the Europeans. Even though the Native American Indians had built towns around these convenient sites, they had no idea as to the original builders of these ruins. To get started, here are William Bartram's descriptions of these ruins from his Travels manuscript. He writes, "In the midst of a large oblong square adjoining this town, which was surrounded with a low bank or terrace, is standing a high pillar, round like a pin or needle. It is about 40 feet in height and between 2 and 3 feet in diameter at the earth, gradually tapering upwards to a point. It is one piece of pine wood and arises from the center of a low, circular, artificial hill, but it leans a little to one side. I inquired of the Indians and traders what it was designed for. They answered that they knew not. The Indians said that their ancestors found it in the same situation when they first arrived and possessed the country, adding that the red men or Indians, then the possessors, whom they vanquished, were as ignorant as themselves concerning it, saying that their ancestors likewise found it standing so. This monument, simple as it is, may be worthy of the observations of a traveler, since it naturally excites at least the following queries. For what purpose was it designed? Its great antiquity and incorruptibility. What method or machines they employed to bring it to the spot, and how they raised it erect. There is no tree or species of the pine whose wood, i.e. so large a portion of the trunk, is supposed to be incorruptible, exposed in the open air to all weathers, but the long-leaved pine, the Pinus palustris, and there is none growing within 12 or 15 miles of this place, that tree being naturally produced only on the high, dry, barren ridges, where there's a sandy soil and grassy, wet savannas. And in another section he writes, the pyramidal hills, or artificial mounds, and highways, or avenues, leading from them to artificial lakes or ponds, vast tetragon terraces, chunk yards, and obelisks or pillars of wood, are the only monuments of labor, ingenuity, and magnificence that I have seen worthy of notice or remark. The region lying between Savannah River and Oak Mulge, east and west, and from the sea coast to the Cherokee or Appalachian Mountains, north and south, is the most remarkable for their high conical hills, tetragon terraces, and chunk yards. This region was last possessed by the Cherokees, since the arrival of the Europeans, but they were afterwards dispossessed by the Muscogees, and all that country was probably many ages preceding the Cherokee invasion, inhabited by one nation or confederacy, who were ruled by the same system of laws, customs, and language, but so ancient that the Cherokees, Creeks, or the nation they conquered could render no account for what purpose these monuments were raised. And here is all that is left of his answer in the document known as Observations. The question was, in the letter which you wrote to me concerning the mounds, you make mention of the Chunky Yard of the Cherokee Indians. What is the nature, use, etc. of this yard? Is this Chunky Yard confined to the Cherokee Indians, or have you observed it among any other tribes of Indians? A sketch of the Chunky Yard will be very acceptable. Answer: the Chunky Yard of the Creeks, so called by the traders, is a cubiform area generally in the center of the town, because the public square and rotunda, or great winter council house, stands at two opposite corners of it. It is generally very extensive, especially in the large old towns, is exactly level and sunk, 2, sometimes 3 feet below the banks or terrace surrounding it. In the center of the yard, there is a low circular mound, or eminence, in the center of which stands erect the Chunky Pole, which is a high obelisk or four-square pillar, declining upwards to an obtuse point, in shape and proportion much resembling the ancient Egyptian obelisk. This is of wood, the heart or inward resinous part of a sound pine tree, and is very durable, generally from 30 to 40 feet in height. He also writes, it is reasonable to conjecture that the Indians anciently were more ingenious and industrious in manufactures when necessity obliged them. Therefore, we must seek for their arts and sciences amongst nations far distant from the settlements of the white people, or recover them by industry and experiments of our own. So from his writing and from the pictures, the drawings that he made of these ruins when he encountered them, we get an idea as to what the ancient ruins of the southeastern United States looked like. So let's hear more about what is hidden in plain sight in Washington, D.C.
Good morning, I'm Elizabeth Wynn Johnson. On the 4th of July, thousands of people will gather here to take in the show overhead, never realizing that something unexpected is right underfoot. Beneath an unmarked manhole cover, a 13.5-foot concrete version of the Washington Monument, tucked inside its brick-lined well since 1898. It's actually a geodetic marker used by 19th century engineers to monitor the ground for movement, because back then, this wasn't a gentle sloping hill. It was marshland.
Very interesting. 13-foot mini-monument, just like some of Bartram's drawings with smaller obelisks beside the main obelisk in the ancient ruins here in ancient America. I don't know how they could have been used together, the large and small obelisks, but someone may figure it out, and the fact remains that it is a very curious similarity. So, again, in this video, I would like to compare the layout of the ancient ruins here in America and the modern cities in which we are finding the so-called Tartarian architecture or architecture before the mud flood. So let's look at Washington, D.C. from the air so that we can see exactly how similar the layout is to that of the ruins in Florida and Georgia. It truly is amazing. You have the long rectangular mall or avenue with the obelisk in the middle and fancy ornate buildings on each end. D.C. is crazy. This area in particular is actually a giant cross or two rectangles with the White House and the Jefferson Memorial on the ends of the second rectangle, which is perpendicular to the first. And this area still contains some of the pools of water. Some other cities have since just transformed them into fountains, or they may be laid out slightly differently, but this basic layout is exactly the same in all cities. You have some kind of long rectangle, again with ornate buildings or former buildings on each end, and fountains or statues or obelisks and strange geometric patterns within this rectangle. Look at some of these buildings. I think some survived the so-called mud flood or reset. In particular, I think the Capitol, half of the Washington Monument, definitely the Smithsonian Castle. But others, I think, were just rebuilt on existing foundations and perhaps with knowledge of the city before it was destroyed. Amazing stuff. DC, like Paris, is full of these rectangular power centers, as I call them. And I will explain this in just a minute, but I think it is highly likely that these areas were designed and built for either literal power generation or simply a way of demonstrating political power. Either way, lost or unknown technology and skill were involved. Next, let's go to Paris. What do you think you would find around the Eiffel Tower? Of course, the Eiffel Tower is the obelisk in the middle of this powerful rectangle. You have the Palais de Chaillot on one side, leading to the mini obelisk and government offices on the other side of this really long rectangle. Wow, the Eiffel Tower is in one very impressive and powerful rectangle. And check out this second site in Paris. It's another one that goes across the river, just like we saw in DC. And with the usual statues and fountains, look at the architecture and those columns. Look at the building on the other end of this rectangle. It is an army museum, and then you have Napoleon's tomb. Truly spectacular, or some may even say ridiculous, that they could do this in whenever they claim these buildings were built. Another curious thing in this area, if you follow these two rectangles, they actually continue on in a thinner rectangle and then they intersect at a small circle containing a statue of the one and only Louis Pasteur, the character who gave us the germ theory of medicine. Wow. And the third site in Paris, a nice rectangle with the Arc de Triomphe and the Louvre on one side, and the Palais de la Concorde and its obelisk on the other end. There are so many buildings with extravagant architecture. I'm just trying to highlight a few, but you can look at these or any other cities to see some amazing rectangular layouts with obelisks, statues, fountains, and malls or avenues in any major city worldwide. Now, regarding the purpose of these sites, as I was researching the ancient ruins in America, I kept thinking that there had to be a purpose for this specific layout, especially given the fact that the same layout was used by the ancients in all of these now Indian towns. At least there were Indian towns in the 1700s. Well, there are only so many reasons that this would have been done, especially given how difficult it would have been to construct these sites. Unless it was built by giants or the Nephilim, otherwise the main reason that I think people would go to such lengths to construct something of this magnitude would be to generate some type of power. So I started looking into possible ways of generating energy from the resources that may have been available, and I'll touch on that in a second. Now, I know that most people think that in ancient Tartaria or before the reset, they had some kind of free energy. And I think that it is definitely possible that they had some kind of advanced technology, given all of the amazing architecture we find worldwide and the strange drawings that we see in ancient literature, especially with the fasces and the fireplaces. But we must also keep in mind that free energy does not mean magical energy. I think we get carried away with the concept of free energy, thinking that you can just stick a pole on a building and all of a sudden you can fly around like the Jetsons in hovercrafts and shoot lasers and never have to work. Although I think it is highly likely that in the past they had more advanced or at least different technology before the reset, it would still involve hard work, physics, engineering of some sort, and not lazy or magical knowledge. Maybe even along the lines of alchemy and the celestial or spiritual forces in our world. What I like to do is to at least start with things that we know, leaving the door open to other possibilities or technologies yet to be rediscovered or re-engineered. So I looked for ways to generate power from nothing other than fire and water, and this led me to thermoelectric power generation, which is definitely a possibility. It may not be exactly what they had, but it definitely would have worked, and that is at least a start. Thermoelectric generators are relatively simple. They require no moving parts. All you need is a temperature differential, and you basically have free energy, especially when combined with biogas, radioactivity, fire, or even just the sun. NASA knows the value of thermoelectric generators. Check out what NASA uses. Plus, we do see many statues and drawings depicting fire in some of the mud flood architecture, monolithic type structures, or above domes. And even our own Lady Liberty is carrying a torch. Torches were often incorporated in what we call Tartarian art and architectures. So the idea of torches or fire and thermoelectric generation deserves consideration. They may have had more advanced or unknown ways of harnessing more energy from fire or the atmosphere. And before I get too far into energy, I would like to emphasize that my main point in this video is not so much how they were generating power, if in fact that is what these areas were used for. Rather, I would like to make the connection that the layout of these ancient American sites is strikingly similar to the layout not only of a few images of Tartaria, as depicted in old books, but more importantly, this layout matches what we see today in Washington, D.C., Paris, Moscow, actually any city worldwide in which we find Tartarian architecture. In these cities, you will find long rectangular areas with an obelisk in the middle, a mall or avenue, extending out to buildings of ornate and amazing architecture on each end of the rectangle. Water is also the important ingredient for these layouts. As Bartram witnessed, the avenues always led to an artificial pond or water area, even if it was next to a creek or lake, which I think most times they were. Now, let's check out a few more cities before I get back into the thermoelectric power, and also some ideas on batteries, and maybe even some other connections. First, I want to check out Kansas City, and you'll see why in a second. Here on the map and aerial view, you can see a basic rectangle with City Hall on one end and the courthouse on the other. And you notice that the courthouse has the interesting half moon or almost amphitheater shape. I've seen this in many cities. This may have been some acoustic resonance type application. Again, very difficult to determine hundreds of years later. But what I wanted to point out in Kansas City lies just beyond City Hall, and that is the Army Corps of Engineers building. Check out the logo of the Army Corps of Engineers. Very interesting. Now, the Army Corps of Engineers could have been the group that first re-entered the destroyed cities, at least in America, after the reset, in order to assess and rebuild the castles and structures, or destroy structures. I was surprised to see their logo because I had just been questioning things in Florida that I thought were built by the Army Corps of Engineers, and I'm referring to these vast tidal creeks or canals that we have and their strange patterns, their geometric patterns and shapes. I actually called the Army Corps of Engineers and confirmed that these were not built by the Corps, but I'll leave that for another video. And just as a disclaimer regarding the American ruins, these mounds, as they are called, may have looked completely different in the time in which they were built. They may have been covered in mud during the mud flood, and maybe they were partially excavated with the old Indian mound story. They may have actually looked even more like the more modern buildings we see in Northern America or in Europe, architecture that we call Tartarian architecture. Or they could just be more ancient. Again, the fact remains that the layout is curiously similar to the sites we see in our modern cities. So moving on, and we have some good cities left here, let's look at St. Louis. I chose two sites in St. Louis, so check out this first one. Amazing patterns from above, and you have all the usual suspects. You have the fountains, the obelisks, and buildings all lined up in a rectangle. Just amazing. Check out the Climatron. Amazing stuff. And of course, we have to look at the arch since we're in St. Louis. And what do you know? It is also located in a rectangular setup similar to the ancient ruins of the southeastern United States. Across the river, you get another park similar to DC and Paris. But look at these shots. The arch and the fountains, they are just amazing. Okay, time for the nitty-gritty. Let's look at three sites in Chicago. Check out this rectangle in the University of Chicago and these buildings. We have towers, fountains, statues, crazy looking stuff. We have full-on castles here in Chicago. And in the second site in Chicago, we have the Soldier Field area. The rectangle is not as defined, but you get the same strange layout and amazing buildings, especially when you take this site as a whole with the Alder Planetarium on the northerly island just across the harbor here. Good old Soldier Field and its architecture. Was it built or just refurbished? It's very interesting. And the third site here in Chicago sits around Buckingham Fountain. An amazing coincidence. The perfect rectangle with fountains and patterns. Check this out from above. So what about Moscow? I will show you three quick sites in Moscow. The first, a nice rectangle, and a statue called "The Children Are the Victims of Adult Vices." How convenient. You get your fountain and your statue. Yep, another coincidence. And a second site in Moscow, we get Red Square. Of course, the Kremlin. What else would you expect in the capital? We have a couple of rectangles here. And again, check out the architecture. It is just stunning. And the third site in Moscow, the Great Bolshoi Theater. And by the way, I visited these sites in Moscow, and I was blown away by the architecture. It is amazing. And here we have a nice rectangle leading to the fountain. amazing coincidence again, how all of these sites are amazingly similar to the rectangular ruins of the ancient sites in America. And this is getting a little bit lengthy, so let me just blaze through a few more cities. First up, we have Baltimore, and check out the fasces and the fasces on the columns. Very interesting. I'm sure we can come up with a lot of possible uses for the fasces and the columns. And we have two sites in Libya, of all places, and even a possible site in good old Daytona Beach. Now, back to thermoelectric generators, it really is as simple as harnessing energy from a temperature differential and using two different conductors. There's even evidence showing that people used differences in barometric pressure to power clocks. In these images, you can see thermoelectric generator setups and devices long ago. Thermoelectric generation is known, and perhaps old ornate fireplaces were simply harnessing thermoelectric power by creating the temperature differential to power simple lighting or other devices that were available back then. We really just don't know. And the iron andirons may have just been electrical connectors for the conductors that would form simple or a complex circuit that also included some sort of heat sink and or a battery. Either way, this is something that can be done even today with wood-burning stoves and fireplaces, so they may have done the same in the past or had even better ways or better technology to do something similar in the past. At least it's a start, and at least it's something. Another thing I want to mention in this regard is that in my readings, the Indians were very particular about fire. They held it in great esteem. Now, after their annual festival called the Feast of First Fruits, they would put out all of the fires in the town, and then the priest would start a new fire, and everyone would use that to light their own personal fires in their homes. And these were well-built homes, not the teepee propaganda you see in movies and on TV. No, these were well-built homes. And curiously, Bartram wrote that the spiral fire on the floor of the rotunda is very curious. It seems to light up in a flame of itself at the appointed time, but how this is effected, I know not. The key word being spiral. And I say this because I was watching Martin Lidke's video called Flat Earth British, What in Tarnations is Going On? And he showed some images that contained almost spiral-like structures, and then a picture showing fire and strange symbols, and even a swastika. So check out this old photograph of the Okmulgee site in Georgia. This mound looks like it could have been a spiral mound. What's even stranger is that I was watching a movie called The First Spaceship on Venus, and this was on Mystery Science Theater where they make fun of old science fiction movies. And what do you know, but they encountered these cone-like structures with iron-looking spirals going up them. But their structures contained holes in the cone part of the structure, and these conical structures were used to generate electricity. Even stranger yet is that in the movie, these structures were filling up with oil, and oil was oozing out from the holes. I'm not 100% sure what to make of this, but one thing is certain, oil is a naturally occurring substance. Just like other naturally occurring things that have been demonized and banned, and I mean things like hemp, marijuana, cotton of all things, radiation, the list goes on, crude oil or petroleum is just as natural and will have some very useful applications as these banned or demonized items. You can actually take a bath in crude oil, I believe it's in Croatia or Azerbaijani, to heal serious skin conditions. Could oil have been used in different ways at these ancient sites? Now, don't take this the wrong way. I think that the current state of oil production and consumption is horrible. It is corporate oil, where they are obviously not using oil in an earth-friendly way. However, let's not let the corporate use and propaganda of oil change our perception of what oil truly is. and that is a naturally occurring resource which should be freely available to everyone, just like food and water. Oil, if used responsibly, is yet another gift from Mother Nature. But oil is a tough one. Most people still can't escape the programming that has demonized oil. We are taught that radiation is bad, oil is bad, certain plants are bad. Well, as with anything in this dualistic reality, it is usually how something is used that determines whether it is good or bad. The current way in which oil is used is, of course, very bad. But again, a more natural, sustainable, and responsible use of oil could be a great benefit to mankind. Similar to water, we should be able to drill a well, use oil responsibly, and enjoy nature's gift of practically free energy through oil. Now, could oil have played a part in ancient power generation? Could ancient depictions of conical structures have been built on oil wells to continuously feed a large flame for unlimited power generation using something similar to thermoelectric generators? Well, again, this is not the main focus of this video, but it should not be discounted without investigation. We shouldn't blindly look for magical free energy to the exclusion of known energy sources that could have been harnessed in a better or more intelligent way in ancient times. Right now, I'm more interested in the layout than the actual technology, but we have to start somewhere if we are going to reverse engineer this stuff. So next, I want to touch on items that could have been used to store energy. And again, these are just ideas, but it is very interesting. At first, I was thinking that the columns and buildings could have been used as batteries, which may be the case. I mean, there has to be a purpose for the similar domes and columns that we see throughout this architecture. And the fluting on the columns may have actually contained something on the outside, like rebar or wiring or pipes used in electrical transmission, storage, or even some kind of plasma or magnetic-based power. Now, back to batteries, there are many possibilities, and at first I thought of the water in these rectangular power centers as being only used for heat sinks to provide the temperature differential. But now I'm also leaning toward what is known as a flow battery. In my search, I first learned about the ancient Baghdad battery, but then I came across the flow batteries, which are a type of electrochemical cell where chemical energy is provided by two chemical components dissolved in liquids contained within the system and separated by a membrane. It is similar to a fuel cell, and it is being touted as futuristic, but it is extremely basic. Examples of these redox flow batteries are the vanadium redox flow battery, polysulfide bromide battery, and uranium redox flow battery. And even Obama knows about flow batteries.
Vanadium redox fuel cells.
What I like is that the power is a function of the surface area of the electrodes. So I wonder if the water along the malls or avenues of these rectangular power centers were actually the electrodes of giant flow batteries. An important feature of the ancient ruins is that the mall or avenue areas were sunken down a few feet below the level of the rest of the land. This seems to be the case still in many of these rectangular parks and cities today. Some will retain this recessed feature, and there will be a few steps down, seemingly for some unknown reason. There are so many possibilities, but the main advantages to these flow batteries are that the layout is flexible, they have long lives, and very low maintenance. But still, the main point for me is that major cities worldwide have curiously similar rectangular layouts containing obelisks, statues, fountains, and Tartarian type architecture and buildings at each end and even along the edges of these rectangles. Now, maybe it is just a magical coincidence, just like when we are dealing with NASA, but I for one find this to be very curious indeed and worthy of further investigation. Well, that's probably enough for one video, and I hope that I have communicated my main point regarding the similarity of the layout of ancient ruins found in Native American villages and the rectangular areas of present-day cities worldwide.
Here in Washington, the best stuff is hidden right there in plain sight.
The moon is hanging in the purple sky. The sun is shining as it's always done. Talking about the rich folks, the poor create the rich hoax, and only late breastfed fools believe it. So don't tell me about your success, nor your recipes for my happiness. Smoking big.